Well, let me take a moment to welcome you to Northstar. Very excited you're here today on this Mother's Day. And we want each and every mother who is here today to know not only do we honor you, but we are so thankful for you, and we are glad that you're here today. And so I'm going to ask at all of our campuses, our Panama City Beach campus, those of you that are watching online, as well as those here at Panama City, let's stand and give a hand to our mothers today. Let's honor them and just thank them for who they are and what they do in our lives. Man, so grateful. So very grateful. So we honor the moms. You know, kids say the darndest things, don't they? It's always amazing to me every year when we do that video. You know, we have to go through and cut things out and say we're probably not going to use that. But anyways, mom, dad, if you want to know what they said, you can talk to Chris and he'll let you know later. But the reality is kids do say the darndest things. In fact, Angela reminded me today. She said, remember, it's Mother's Day. I said, I know that, sweetheart. She said, remember the story of your great friend and what happened on Mother's Day. I had a friend who had invited a guest speaker to speak on Mother's Day. He was a leader in their denomination, and that speaker was there that Sunday. And he got up to speak, and my friend had his granddaughter there with him and his family. They were excited. His kids were there, and they were looking forward to Mother's Day, spending some time together. After the preacher began to preach, probably around 12 o'clock, he wasn't through. He continued to go on to about 12:15, at which my friend's granddaughter stood up on the front row and yelled out in a loud voice, would somebody please shut this man up? It's Mother's Day. So moms, I'm going to do my best to get you out on time. And if I don't, I'm going to ask you to please control your children. Mom, I want you to know today, for every one of you that is a mother, that God sees you and that he is cheering for you no matter where you are or what you're doing on your journey as a mother. And I hope more than anything else that today's message can be encouraging to you and that it will help you on your journey as a mom and that you will be able to accomplish everything that God wants you to accomplish as a mom. You got to always be careful what you say to the preacher. Brenton Hitchcock, when he was walking in today, said, Pastor, give me a shout out. So, Brenton, here's what I'm going to say. If everybody would treat their mom like Brenton does and how he treats his wife, Katie, this would be a better world. Brenton, I hope that helps a little bit. And I hope you did what I think you did. I hope you were really good to your wife, Katie, and I hope you were good to your mom. If not, maybe this shout-out will help. We're going to talk today in this series, Faith Over Fear, about what to do when anxiety attacks. Let's just be honest. We live in a day and an age where anxiety is probably at a higher rate than it's ever been in the lives of individuals. In fact, I want to begin today by asking you this question. What are you anxious about? What are you worried about? What is it in your life today that you are struggling with? Is it your finances? Is it your job? Are you worried about school? Are you worried about your kids, your weight, your schedule? Are you worried about the war that we see in this world today? Are you worried about the economy? Are you worried about politics? Are you worried about COVID? I don't know what it is, but this is an age of anxiety. People are worried more than they've ever been worried. They're more anxious than they've ever been anxious. And people seem to be uptight about everything. You probably noticed that, right? And it's just amazing how people can just go off at a moment's notice. I heard a story this week about two stockbrokers that were talking to each other, and they were having this conversation, and one of them said to the other, he said, I'm worried sick about the economy. The other one said, I'm not. He said, actually, I have hired a professional worrier. I pay him to do all the worrying for me so that I don't have to worry about anything. His friend looked at him, he said, man, how much is that costing you? He said, $100,000 a year. He said, how in the world are you going to pay for that? He said, that's not my worry, that's his. The Bible says in Proverbs that anxiety in the heart brings a man down. It weighs a heart down. The old English word for worry literally means to choke or to strangle. And many of us, we're living with anxiety today. We find ourselves at a place that we worry about things probably way more than we've worried in the past. And that is what worry does to us. Worry does not work in our lives. It's like a rocking chair. I mean, you're going back and forth, but it is not going to get you anywhere in your life as long as you're filled with anxiety and worry. Research has shown that 40% of all the worries that you worry about are about the future, and they're never going to happen. Did you know that 30% of the worries are about the past, and those are things that cannot be changed no matter how much you try to change them or you worry about them? 12% are what they call needless worries about our health. 10% are petty worries, not worth worrying about anything. And then 8% are legitimate concerns. So only 8% of what you worry about really, truly matters. Did you know that most of our anxiety comes from one thing? And this is going to be a shocker to some of you. But the majority of the anxiety that you feel in your life is your desire and your need to control things. You see, typically, the more out of control that you feel, the more overwhelmed you feel, is because you are doubling down your efforts to gain control in your life. I can say that it's true in my life. We try to control it more. We get hyper-controlled. We will micromanage. We will do everything we can to make sure that it doesn't get out of our control. In fact, we will force ourselves and we will use willpower to try to make what we want work out the way we think it should work out. You don't believe that? Parents, let me just remind you, we do this to our kids, right? Our kids begin to grow up and all of a sudden they begin to show some independence. And the first thing that we do, and when they start showing examples of independence, is we get together and we say, we're not going to allow this to get out of control. We're going to get a handle on this. We're going to do everything we can to nip this in the bud right now because we want to make sure that this doesn't get out of control. And we'll say things like, you're grounded for the rest of your life because we want to be in control and we're worried about our kids and we're going to control it and we're going to control it now, right? We're going to get on top of this right now. And so much of the stress in your life is caused by this desire to micromanage everything in your life. In fact, to control everything, you kind of put yourself in a place that you say, I want to be the manager of the universe. If I can control it my way and do it my way, then everything is going to be a lot better. And the more that you try to control, the harder you try to control the things that are uncontrollable in your life, the more overwhelmed and filled with anxiety and worry you will be. And so in this series, we're talking about faith over fear, how to live a life that is less anxious, how to live a life that is not full of worry. The fact is that most of us don't realize that it really is out of control. In fact, most of us haven't figured this out yet. The Bible calls life a mystery. God not only glorifies in revealing things, but God also glorifies himself in concealing things. I want you to think about that just for a moment. God intentionally doesn't tell us certain things about life. Now, I know what you're thinking. You're probably saying, why? Why does he not tell us certain things about life? You see, to force us to rely upon himself is what he is wanting to do. He's wanting us to know that, hey, it's not under your control. You're not in control. Now, you may think you're in control. I remember one time Angela and I were sitting with a psychologist, and she looked at me and Angela, and she said, control is an illusion. Think about that just for a moment. Man, that was a sobering thought. I begin to think to myself, how many times do I think that I'm in control? And what God wants is he wants us to depend on him. There are some things that you are never going to figure out. There are some things that you are never going to control. In fact, let me just say this. Do you know what happens when we lose control or when things are out of control? Do you know how we typically react? When we feel overwhelmed or anxious or we're worried, we always use these two words, or it could just be one word. We say, but how? How? How in the world am I going to get it all done on time? How in the world am I going to pay my bills? How in the world am I going to solve this problem? How in the world am I going to get that person to love me again? And so what we do is we say, but how? How am I going to accomplish this? How am I going to do this? So let me just ask you a question. Let me just make a statement. Let's admit it. In a crowd this size at both of our campuses and for those that are listening online, there are many of us that are control freaks. And the reason that there is so much anxiety in our life is because we want to control things. You have this innate desire to control everything around you because you know that you'd make the world a better place if you were in control, right? And I laugh because I probably have thought that in my own life. Personally, if they just let me be in charge, everything would be better, right? And that's what you do as a leader. That's what you do as an individual who wants to control. You have this innate desire to control everything. And you think to yourself, if everybody else would just let me rule the world, everything would be perfect. If everybody in my family would just do what I tell them to do, everything would be great. If everybody at work would just listen to me, we would be way more successful and work would be a better place because I know exactly what I'm talking about. Life would be grand if I was in charge. So you have this need to control, right? You want to control your kids. You want to control your life. You want to control your finances. You want to control the circumstances of life. You want to control everything that you can. And when you look at things that you can't control or you hear things that you cannot control, it just bugs you to the end, doesn't it? And man, you get anxious and you get worried. And what you do is you double down and you say, man, I'm going to work harder and I'm going to try harder and I'm not going to control it because you've got this need to control. There's a verse in the Bible that speaks to this. Now, it's not the one we're going to look at today, but I want you to hear what it says. I think God put it there for every single one of us that struggle with this idea of control. In Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5, it says, trust God from the bottom of your heart. Don't try to figure out everything on your own. Man, doesn't that sound familiar? Don't try to figure out everything on your own. I don't have to figure it all out. That's the most important lesson in this life. I can't figure it all out. And the more you try and the harder you work at it, the more you are going to be worried and anxious, and the more you're going to find yourself in just being kind of, I guess you could say, tightened up inside because you're going to worry, you're going to have anxiety, you're going to be stressed. In fact, if you try to figure out God, I think this is important. If you try to figure out God, you're going to be severely frustrated because God can't be figured out. And man, I learned that lesson early on in life. He's much bigger than your brain can handle, and you can't figure out all the details of him. And every time you try to figure out why God does what he does, you're going to be disappointed and frustrated because God is not, I don't even know if this is a word, God's not figure outable, right? He's not. That's what makes him God. You can't put him in a box. Sometimes we try to put him in a box and say, hey, let's systematize him. You know, let's put him in a box and try to figure out who he is. What makes him God is that we can't figure that out. Now, that's easy to think. It's easy to say, but it's a hard lesson to learn. And the lesson that we've got to learn, the powerful thought that I want to focus on for a few moments today is just simply this. Whatever is bugging you in your life right now, and I know that it's bugging you because you can't control it. That's why you're stressed out. That's why you're anxious. That's why you find yourself worrying about the situation continually because you want to control it. You want to do what you can do. But here's the thing I want you to know. If you need to understand that, it's important that you understand that it's out of your control. But it's under God's control. You see, it's out of your control. But it's under God's control. It's not out of his control. He can manage the situation. He can manage the circumstances, whatever it is. Now, it's easy to think that, right? It's easy for me to sit here today and say, listen, you need to think this way. You need to understand that it's not out of God's control. God has complete control of it. And you're probably thinking to yourself, that's easy to say. It's a lot harder to live, isn't it? Right? It's way more difficult in the circumstances of life to go, all right, I'm not in control here. God is, and I'm just going to trust him, and I'm going to believe him, and I think that God is going to help me to overcome this in my life. Now, the secret to overcoming anxiety, the antidote to anxiety, is to let go and to let God. So today, what I want to do for the next few moments is I want to look at a passage of Scripture that talks about this, that shows us that in our life, we have to let go and we have to let God. We have to be willing to say, I'm not in control, I'm going to trust God. And in trusting God, I know that ultimately what's going to happen in life is that God is going to be in complete control of the circumstances and the situation. So the question becomes, how do we do that? How do we let go and how do we trust God in our life? I think that's a great question to ask because I know that it's not simple for me. I know that I've had to learn this over time and I don't get it perfect every single time. I don't get it right every time in my life. So three things that we're going to look at in this passage of Scripture that we're going to look at today. We're going to look at a passage of Scripture that's found in Philippians chapter 4, verses 6 through 7. And in these two verses, they're there in your notes, it'll be up here on the screen, I want you to listen to what the Apostle Paul is writing about. Now, it's important to understand that he's writing from prison. He's not in control. In fact, his life is probably way out of control in the context that he's not controlling anything in his life in this moment. And here he is, he's penning some words to those that live in Philippi, and he's saying, here's some things I want you to know. And he says this, and I think what he says is so powerful. As we look at it, I want you to just think about it for a moment. Here's what he says. Don't worry about anything. Now, if you're like me, I read that and I go, ha ha, that's easy to say, right? It's easy to say. Don't be anxious about anything. Don't worry about anything. Don't get stressed about anything. Instead, pray about everything. Notice what he says. Pray about everything. Tell God what you need and thank him for all that he has done. And he says, when you do this, when you tell God what you need, when you thank him for all that he's done, when you pray about everything in your life, he says, there is a result, there is something that happens. And notice what he says. He says, then you will experience God's, what's the word there? Peace, that's right. Then you will experience God's peace. And that's what every single one of our hearts long for. We want peace. We want there to be peace in our family. We want there to be peace at work. We want there to be peace in our marriage. We want there to be peace at the job. We want there to be peace in the world, right? We want peace. We long for peace. We desire peace in our lives. And if you don't, let me just tell you this. You're probably sick. Something's wrong, right? We want peace. We desire peace. Listen to what it says. Which exceeds anything that we can understand. His peace, talking about the peace that God will give you, will guard your hearts and minds as you live in Christ Jesus. So the question that I want us to answer today in these next few moments is, what is the secret to overcoming anxiety? What do we do? How do you and how do I live in a way that as we read this passage of Scripture, that we let go and we let God be in control? How do we accomplish that in our lives on a daily basis? And I think there are three things here that Paul points out that we can do that actually allow us to be able to experience the peace of God, to be able to live a life that's a lot less anxious and stressed and worried. And so I want to begin today by asking you a question. What are you worried about today? Now, I can't answer that, but I want you to think about it. What are you worried about today? What in your life is the one thing that you're losing sleep over? The one thing that's constantly at the forefront of your mind? The one thing that you are constantly struggling through and struggling with and trying to figure out and you don't know what to do? What is that one thing that continually is in the front of you? Listen to what Paul says. He says there are three things that we have to do if we want to let go and we want to let God be in control and to realize that he is in control, that he can give us this peace that he talks about. The first thing that he tells us is, he says the first thing you've got to do every day is you got to pray about everything. Pray about everything. Now, here's what Paul's saying. Rather than worry or becoming anxious or getting stressed, take everything in your life to God. We're going to talk about this in a minute. Why is that? Because he's in control. He is the only one that can resolve the issues that you're worried about. He's the only one that can take care of the things that you're struggling with. Go back and look at the verse. It says, don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about, and what's the word there? Say it out loud. Pray about what? Everything. It doesn't say pray about the things that you think are big. It doesn't say pray about the things that you think are important. It doesn't say pray about the things that you're overwhelmed by. It says pray about everything. Not just the big things. And isn't that what we normally do? We take the big things to God, right? This is a big thing in my life. This is something huge, and you know, I need God to be involved in this. But we don't pray about the little things. And what Paul is saying is that if you really want to have peace in your heart, God is concerned about every single detail of your life. What does that mean, pray about everything? Well, listen, in the original Greek, which is what the New Testament was written in, the word everything means everything. See, some of y'all are like, man, he's got some big word he's fixing to teach us. No. Everything means everything. It means all the details of your life. I got to tell you, I really believe this. In fact, in recent days, God has been teaching me this tremendously in my life. I'm going to tell you two stories just recently that have happened in our life. But many of you know we're trying to get back in our new facility, and we've been praying about, you know, what's the timing of that and what does God want to do. And you've heard me stand up here and say, hey, we're only 4 to 6 weeks out. And then I come back and say, well, you know, this happened and we're not really sure what's going to happen. And the last time we were together, we were talking with the company that's coming in to do all the FF&E, which is basically furniture and fixtures and things like that. And that just basically means like all the speakers, the sound equipment, all of those things that are necessary for us to do what we do, as well as the kids' furniture for their classrooms and all those things. And if you've ordered furniture lately, you know where I'm going with this. Like we've been told it could be 6 months, it could be a year, right? And so, you know, I just said, man, I am just struggling with this. And you know, I'll be honest with you. I'm just being transparent here. I really wasn't praying about it. I was like, it is what it is. I mean, it's going to be 6 months. It's going to be a year. And, you know, you've heard me say we need to pray about this. And so last Tuesday, we were together as a staff, and we were praying. And I remember I came across this passage of Scripture, and God just said to me, Marty, pray about everything. And so in the middle of our prayer time, I just stopped, and I just said, God, you know what? We're being told by all of these companies it could be 6 to 8 months before any of this stuff gets here. And you know what? It is stressful, and I am anxious on the inside, and I am worried, and I don't know what to do. And God, the only thing I know to do is just pray. And so I just prayed. I prayed, and I prayed, and I prayed. And then when we finished our staff prayer time, we were kind of individually praying. I just stood up and told our staff, I said, we're going to pray about this. We've got equipment from Sweetwater that hadn't come in 8 months. And I don't know where it's at. We ain't got an email. We don't know where it is. We don't know what's happening. And it's probably not going to be here. And we got a phone call with CTI. And they're telling us that some of this equipment hasn't even been made yet. And we don't even know how we're going to get it. But here's what I know. God is in control, not us. And we're just going to pray. And so we prayed and we prayed and we prayed. And we asked God. We said, God, we're just trusting you. And so you know what? Thursday, we had a meeting with CTI. The guys called me, and they said, Pastor Marty, you ain't going to believe this. I said, what's that? They said, CTI said that they didn't expect any of the equipment to be here, but it's all in their warehouse, ready to be shipped on January the 1st. They're coming with it. They'll be here. They're going to install it. I'm like, praise God. Isn't that amazing? But not only that, listen, not only that, the company that's doing the kids' equipment, they come in, they walk through the facility, they look at Josh, and they say, hey, we just want you to know, we think we're going to be able to get everything here on time, and we think that everything, in fact, we've got all the stuff, we're going to bring it with us, we're going to come, we're going to install it, and you guys should be on target for the end of June to be able to move in the facility. Everything is here, we can't believe it. It's a miracle to us, but guess what? It's a miracle to us too, right? I mean, we're sitting on the other side going, there is no way. And guys, can I tell you something? There's no way we prayed on Tuesday and Thursday all this good news came in. I'm just like, you know what, God? It's all you. Pray about everything. Furniture. Who prays about furniture? I mean, seriously, who prays about furniture? I was getting ready this morning. I ordered Angela a dining room suit last year in the month of March. Never prayed about it, just ordered it because that's what she wanted. Well, it didn't come in until this March. And I was looking in the mirror this morning brushing my teeth. I said, you dummy, you should have prayed that furniture here. Good Lord, have mercy, man. Did you not learn a lesson? And so this morning, I got on my knees. We're waiting for this thing that goes on the end of our bed. I don't know what you call it. It's some kind of where you sit on it and, you know, whatever. I don't know what it is. But they told me it wouldn't be here until probably June or maybe even July or August. Well, I'm praying about it now. I'm like, you know what? Y'all can say that, but God cares about furniture. I don't know why, but I'm just believing it. Everything he says. I want you to think of something right now in your life. I want you to think about something right now in your life that is overwhelming you, something that you just think, you know what, man, God doesn't care about that. I mean, God's not concerned about that. And here's what I want you to know. You're thinking to yourself, I can't bother God with that. Can I tell you, I was thinking to myself the other day, I can't bother God with furniture. Come on, man. Are you kidding me? God, we need the furniture to get here so we can get in the building. You know, everybody keeps telling me, just trust God. He's got a plan. You know, God, he'll get it here when he wants to get it here. But you know, when we got on our knees and started praying about it, he did it way faster than anybody thought it could be done, right? And so in my mind, I'm thinking to myself, how many of us think we can't bother God? It's just stupid. It's not that important. But you know what? You're worried about it. And he's the only one that can control it. And until you take it to him and you tell him, God, I am trusting that you can take care of this. If you're here today and you're a teacher, let me just say this. Maybe you're thinking to yourself, I need more time to teach and less time with interruptions. Take it to God. God, I need less interruptions in my class this week. I need you to help me because, God, I know that you care about these kids and I know you want them to learn, and I'm just trusting you to take care of this. If you're here today and you're a server and you're thinking to yourself, I need more tips, but man, I just don't want to ask God for that. That seems selfish. I need some happy customers, right? Pray about it. God, send me some people that are happy, not people that are miserable, right? I want some happy people, people that tip good, Lord. I mean, that would be nice, right? And you've heard me say this before at Northstar. If you go to Northstar and you don't tip well, please don't leave any card stating anything about our church. I'm just telling you, don't do it. I mean, don't. It's God's reputation that's at stake, not yours. And if you proclaim the name of Jesus, it's just been a rule in my household. My kids were talking about this other night. They said, Daddy, you taught us if we go out to a restaurant and we're going to eat, then we better have the money to be able to tip well. And if we can't, then we don't need to go. Go through McDonald's or Wendy's or somewhere else. But don't go to a sit-down restaurant unless you've already decided that's what you're going to do. Now, you may think I'm being crazy, but I'm being serious. Mom, maybe you're here today. You say, I need a mental break. Can I tell you something? Pray about it. God help me. You're the only one that can control this. Grandparents, maybe you're overwhelmed about your grandchildren's future. Pray about it. You can take everything to God. Student, maybe you're here today and you feel the pressure at school to fit in and you're worried about it and there's anxiety inside of you because your peers are pressuring you. Pray about it. Take it to God. Tell him and watch what he begins to do. Maybe you're here and you're single today and you're worried about a future spouse. Listen, you can take it to God. You can take everything to God. That's what it says. Pray about everything. There's nothing that you can't pray about, because when you do, he gives a peace. I've seen what can happen when we pray. I've seen what God will do when we begin to trust him. You can genuinely pray and want to, you can't genuinely pray and want to be in control. When you genuinely pray, you realize that you're not in control, and you say to God, God, this is in your hands. I'm going to trust you. And let me just tell you something. You need to walk away from it and keep your cotton picking hands out of it, right? Because what we do is, God, I'm going to trust you. But then we're right back over there going, let me control it, right? If you're going to trust him, trust him. And just step back and say, God, I'm going to put this into your hands. So what does Paul say? He says, if you're going to let go and let God, first you got to pray about everything. The second thing he says is this. Secondly, you got to tell God what you need. Now, there's a difference. You got to be specific, right? God, here are the needs in my life. Rather than worrying or becoming anxious or getting stressed out, you got to go to God and say, God, here are the needs. Here are the needs in my life. In fact, this week I was reading and I heard a story about a man that got to heaven. He went to heaven and there were these warehouses in heaven. And God was walking with him and showing him around. And the Lord took him into this one and he saw all these great gifts. He saw cars. He saw homes. He saw spiritual situations. He saw vacations, girlfriends and boyfriends. He saw million-dollar checks. And he says, what are these? God looks at him and he says, every one of them has a tag on them. He said, do you know what the tag reads? Every tag says the same thing. Never ask for. Never ask for. You see, we have not because we ask not. We have not because we want to control. And how much more would you have if you just simply asked God? If you just went to him and said, you know what, Lord? You tell me in my life that what am I supposed to do? I'm supposed to tell God what I need. And these are needs in my life. These are things specifically that I'm praying for and that I'm trusting you for. In Numbers chapter 16, verse 32, it says, God is the source of all life. Everything in the heavens and the earth belongs to the Lord. He is in control of every single bit of it. And specific prayers get specific answers. General prayers get general answers. And God's teaching me this in my life. I'm getting way more specific. Way more specific. My daughter, Ashley, is 30 this year. I've been praying for her husband. And you know, I used to pray generally. Man, I'm praying specific. And you know the one thing that I pray every night for him? I pray that he loves Jesus with all of his heart. That's the one thing that I think will change everything else. And I just tell God, I pray that he is a man that loves Jesus. and that he loves Jesus and he longs for Jesus to be the center of his life, because I know that if that is the case, then everything else is going to work itself out. But I get specific. I pray specific prayers. I asked Ashley one day, I said, what color hair do you want him to have? What color eyes? I'll pray. I'm just believing God. He's in control. I'm just going to let him be in control. My wife laughs at me all the time. She says, she's not ready to be married. It's okay. Be specific. God is the source of everything that you need. The faster you figure this out, the less you're going to worry. The less you're going to be stressed. The less that you're going to be anxious. I saw a study this week. It was talking about the fact that God is the supplier of every resource that we need in our life. And I wrote some of these down because it just reminded me to let go and to let God. You see, when I don't know what to do, the Bible says that God is my wisdom. He is the source of wisdom. If you need wisdom, all you got to do is ask him for it, and he'll give you wisdom over the decisions that you need to make. When I run out of energy, God is my source of strength. And he can give you the strength to move on. He can give you the strength to accomplish what it is that you need to accomplish. When I feel like that everything is caving in and depressing me, God is my source of happiness. All I have to do is say, God, I've been depressed, and I need you to lift me up out of this and to put some joy into my life. It tells us that God is the source of hope when I'm hopeless, when I'm down and I don't know what the future holds. God is the source of my hope. When life becomes stressed out, God is my source of peace. It says he will give you a peace that surpasses all understanding. When I'm irritated about I'm about to blow up, God is my source for patience. He is the one that will give me the patience to overlook some of the things that I need to overlook and to be able to move forward. When I'm overwhelmed with guilt, God is the source of my salvation. There is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. The word condemn means guilt. There's no guiltiness for us if we are in Christ. And when I feel like giving up, God is the source of my encouragement. I mean, I don't know about you, but man, when I think about God, we've got a great God. He's the source of everything that we need. This week was May the 4th. I don't know how many of y'all, I'm sorry, this week was May the 4th, and it was, would the 4th be with you? Many of y'all know, like Star Wars, right? So I was thinking back, I was like, maybe I should have called this sermon, May the Source Be With You, right? Because Jesus is the source of everything that we need in life. And if we're looking to anything else, we're going to come up empty every single time. We're going to worry every single time. We're going to be anxious every single time in our life. And so we have to look to him. And then the third thing that he tells us to let go and to let God is not only do we have to allow him to tell or to tell God everything that you need, the third thing we do is we thank God for what he has done in our lives, for what he has done. I don't have a whole lot of time, but let me just talk about this for a moment. This is an attitude of gratitude. Literally, to stop and to think about what God has done in your life and to be thankful for it. To just say to God, God, I thank you for everything that you've done. I mean, when I look out today, the climate of the political things that are happening around us religiously and racially, it's taking a toll on families. Today's Mother's Day, when families get together, can I tell you something? There's probably a lot more regret that is going on than there is, than there is thanks. Because many people, there's just stress in their family. There's anxiety in their family over the things that are happening. There's more resentment than remembrance. And that clouds over a family and the time that we spend together when we're with our moms, when we're with each other and we're celebrating. Or perhaps there are other situations that are going on in your life that bring anxiety and doubts rather than comfort and peace. Gratitude is a powerful thing in your life. Man, I got to tell you, if you don't know this, gratitude, where gratitude is in the heart, anxiety and worry and fear cannot exist. In fact, did you know there was a study done? This is real. There was a study done that said when a person is full of gratitude, when a person has thankfulness in their heart, there cannot exist anxiety and worry and stress. Now, guys, that's powerful. And that's exactly what Paul is telling us here. He's saying, and thank him for all that he has done. Why do we thank him? Because it's an attitude of gratitude. God, thank you for everything that you have done in my life, all that you've been doing in my life. And there are benefits to gratitude. I was looking at it this week, and I looked at the benefits. Let me just tell you some of them very quickly. There are 8 benefits of having an attitude of gratitude. First of all, increase self-confidence and self-esteem. You're more confident when you're grateful. You know why? Because God puts a peace in your heart. And so you're confident. But notice this, you feel more thankful and blessed when you have gratitude in your hearts. When you begin to write it down, talk about it, think about it, tell God about it, all of a sudden you begin to realize, man, I am blessed. I am blessed beyond measure. People multiply in value when you are grateful. You see them with great value. You feel healthier and happier. You see things with clearer eyes. Life becomes simpler. Physical and mental health improves. You stop comparing yourself to others, and you become more active rather than reactive in life. So, how do we express gratitude on a daily basis? Let me tell you something we did today, because Angela knew that I was going to talk about this. This morning, mothers, we're giving you something called a gratitude journal. And I want to just challenge you to do something this week. I want you to go home and to take the time to begin to write down the things that you're grateful for. I dare you. And I dare you to get up every day and say, God, today, here are the things that I'm grateful for. And you write them down and you start reading through them. And I promise you, you're going to watch the anxiety and you're going to watch the stress and you're going to watch the worry in your life begin to diminish. Because where there is gratitude, worry and anxiety and stress cannot exist in the mind where a person is grateful. And that is why Paul specifically tells us, hey, thank him for all that he has done. Thank him for everything that he is doing in your life. So, when you go to work this week, let me tell you another way that you can be thankful. You can thank the people that are around you. You can thank the people that are around you. Thank the people that, maybe your coworkers, maybe your children for what they've done, maybe your spouse, maybe a server, maybe someone who holds the door for you, or maybe someone who brings you coffee. Now listen, this is going to be controversial, but watch this. Thank the person who cuts you off in traffic. God, I thank you that he just cut me off in traffic. You know what? He probably just saved me from a car accident. Praise Jesus. And you know what? It just slowed me down. Thank the person that cusses you out. Thank you for cussing me out. It just reminded me that God's in control. See, some of y'all are like, man, that ain't never going to happen. I'm just telling you. Thank you. Thank the person that gets mad with you. Thank the person that takes your parking spot this week. Now, I know what you're thinking, Pastor Marty, you're crazy. No, listen to me. It's easy to say thank you to those that have done something for you. It's a lot harder to say thank you to those who have taken something from you. Learn to be grateful. God, I don't know why they cut me off. I don't know what's going on in their life. Man, I've had people cuss me out before. You know what I do? I walk out and go, hurt people. Don't know what's going on in their life. I had somebody with me one time. I left a big tip. Probably the worst service I'd ever gotten in a restaurant. They said, how in the world can you do that? I said, because you don't know what's going on in their life. You don't know what the person before us was like. You don't know what they put up with today. And you know what I've learned? I've just learned to be grateful. God, I'm just thankful that they were able to serve me as I was here in this restaurant. And no, it may not have been the greatest service, but I can be a blessing to them. See, it's an attitude. It's an attitude of the heart. It's looking at life differently and saying, God, I want you to know that I want to be full of thankfulness. So I want you to imagine with me as we close. What would happen if you truly let go and let God? Mom and Dad, what if you let go and let God? Can I tell you what I think would happen? I think you'd have more peace in your life. I think you'd not sweat the small stuff anymore. You'd begin to say, man, it just doesn't matter. You would be much happier and experience more joy. You would not take things so seriously all the time. You'd feel much better about life. You'd be way more content. You'd relax a lot more, and people would love to be around you. I'm serious. And I want you to imagine with me what our homes would be like and what our community would be like and what our church would be like and what our world would be like if every single one of us just said, you know what, we're just going to begin to live differently. And there would be, trust me, there would be less anxiety in the churches and in the community and in the world around us. There'd be more fun. There'd be a lot less outbursts of anger. There'd be much more joy expressed. Kindness towards others would flow, just unselfishly. We would be at a place that there'd be a lot more peace in the world, and generosity towards others would be extended. Life would be way more meaningful for everyone if we all would just let go and let God. I long for this to be true in your home. I long for it to be true in your marriage. I long for it to be true in your family. I long for it to be true in our church, that every single one of us would let go and let God, because there would be a lot less anxiety, a lot less fear, a lot less worry, and a lot less stress for each and every one of us. So today, I pray that you'll let go of whatever it is you're worrying about, and that you'll let God. And can I make a promise to you, because I've seen him do it in my life. I promise you that he'll give you a peace that surpasses everything that you could ever imagine or understand, because that's who he is. Let's pray together. Father, I thank you that your word is true and that it never returns void. And I thank you today that, God, what you say to us is that when anxiety attacks, we have to let go, and God, we have to let you be in control, because our desire is to control things. And so, Heavenly Father, I pray today over each and every one of us that you would let us be able to apply the truth of what we have heard, that we would get up, we would walk out of here today from where we are, and God, we would decide that we are going to trust you and allow you to fulfill the promise that you make, and that is that when we let go and we trust you, that God, we pray about everything. We tell you the specifics of what we need in our life. And then, God, we begin to say to you that we trust you and that we are grateful for all that you have done, that you give us a peace that surpasses all understanding. And today, I pray that peace over moms and dads, over children, over singles, over every single one of our lives. May we experience that peace as we live it out with you. For we pray this in Jesus' name. And all of God's people together said, amen and amen.